everyone. I'm Jenn Colella, and we are all together right now for What's on Stage in London and Theater Mania in New York. And what we have right now is an opportunity for me to meet the Beverly Bass of London. Alice, I am so delighted to make your acquaintance. I cannot believe my luck. Can I see your face and just say, hi, friend. Hi.
How are you? Honey, I am literally fangirling. When they said to me, you know, we've got a little promo that we'd like you to do, you know, it's just maybe a little interview on Zoom with Jenn Colella, I literally fell off my chair and I went, this is basically Christmas.
How dare you? I feel the same way. I can't believe my luck. I'm so excited that I get to have the opportunity to chat with you. All things come from away. And specifically, I've got some questions about playing Beverly and Annette. Okay, good. Okay, so I'm gonna jump in. Okay. During Me in the Sky, or Me and This Guy, which I like to call it sometimes, how do you handle phlegm, spit, other vocal hindrances when there's so little time to swallow or clear your throat? Like
there is no time. And actually, I noticed this. It was a while ago, and I had allergic reaction. I won't name who it was, but they sprayed an aerosol close to the stage. And I have a little bit of an allergy to aerosols, only specific ones, but like it was a deodorant that I was allergic to. And I noticed about 10, 15 minutes into the show, I went, oh, I think I've got, now I'm not like super allergic to it, but I does start to clog up and I start to go like that. And I was like, how do I manage this? I said, I can't, all I do, as long as I do that and I swallow, I'm kind of okay. So just keep going. And then of course I get to Me in the Sky and I realize, I have no moments to actually do that. There's no moments where the mic gets turned off and you can go,
that's right.
And there's nothing. So it was like I was swallowing really hard, just like I'm just and doing this really like, and everyone in the audience, I think, were having sort of an angina attack because I was just sort of like, they knew I was going through it and sort of thinking, how is this happening? But yeah, so actually I have noticed how difficult it is to have any breaks. And it's never, I don't think I've ever had a song or ever sung anything or played a part where I've not been able to have that, at least a tiny moment, like I'm talking 3 seconds, to actually have a swallow. So I think essentially it's like sort of pray a little bit, pray to the theatre gods that they sort of support me. If I have to have a coughing fit, hope the audience go with me and hope that they love live theatre. You know, I've had lots of other shows where it's happened, but honestly, it's never been as bad as Me in the Sky. And I can't, and I, it is actually amazing that that's your first question, because that's a really interesting thing to find out. And I teach a lot, and a lot of my students will be like, what do you do? And it's like, what can you do? You have that's to just right. sort of keep going. You have to find whatever it is that, and sometimes you have to just cough.
Sometimes you have to cough. That's why my Beverly's so growly, because I'll try to, if I have phlegm, I'm like, I'll just like.
Oh, like 100%, like do the Tina Turner version is what I like to call it if I have a cough.
It's the only way that I can.
Oh, there we go. So now I know why you grab on. I love that. That's great.
Yeah, that's it. That's all. That's the only reason. Thank you. That's so helpful. I really appreciate it. It feels nice to share with somebody else who has to like stick. We have to stick the landing every time, right? There's no like kind of doing it. So thank you for walking me through that. It feels better to know that somebody else knows what that's like.
Listen, if I've taught Jenn Colella anything in this Zoom, I'm absolutely thrilled. I'm going to die happy.
You're going to teach me so much, my friend. So much indeed.
Right, now listen, I'm desperate to get into the cruxes, because you've been with this show since, I mean, when was the year that you first like started with this show?
2015,
right. So you've been with it from its concept and from its like, you know, its origins. And I've always been interested, because I've done some workshops, but I've never really been involved in a show where it's literally started in workshops, it's been developed, it's had its run, and then it's been a phenomenon, which is what Come From Away has been. And I would love to know, did you have any clue, or when did it come to your mind, you went, I think this is brilliant? Or has it ever, you know what I mean? Did it ever, was it that you had to wait? When was that moment for you?
That's a great question, my friend. I wasn't certain, to be honest, when I read the script. I was like, oh gosh, there's a lot of direct address, and I'm not sure if this is as funny as it thinks it is, and I don't know if the warmth, I feel that these people are being sweet, but I don't know if that's gonna actually really, yeah, happen on stage. And then it was the first preview at La Jolla in 2015 when we heard the audience's response, when they started to really laugh heartily. There's a moment in the show pretty early on where you can feel the audience like settle in and be like, oh, I see what's happening here. I get who these people are. And they decide to go on the ride with us.
Yeah.
And we really felt that the first time in La Jolla with that first laugh. I believe it was STFD, slow the F down.
Yes.
And they kind of roared and we were like, oh, wait a minute. And then it just continued to grow. It wasn't just laughter. It was the gasps. It was them on their feet at the end. You know, the band playoff. Used to just be the band playing and for people to leave, but they wouldn't leave. So that's when Kelly choreographed it to be a thing because the audience wasn't leaving. It was supposed to be play out.
Oh, that is brand new information to
isn't
me.
Isn't that cool?
I love that. I love that.
Yeah, people wouldn't leave because they just experienced something that they were so thrilled with and they just started staying and clapping with the band. So we kept it in as part of the show. Okay, my next question for you is, what is your worst flubbed line or lyric?
Oh, do you know what? It wasn't that long ago, actually. I'm normally quite good because I've got the moments to run lines just before I say things in the show because you've got like sort of bits.
I do the same thing.
But the worst one actually happened to me in the sky, and it was because, and I cursed myself, Jen, because I was learning a song for a concert, okay? Uh-huh. And it was June is Busting Out All Over. Now, listen, have seen the famous June is Busting Out All Over video. We all have.
Sweet
and I was
love.
Going, I'm terrified because these lyrics are really hard. It's really terrible. I'm gonna completely fumble. I'm gonna be terrible. And we were all laughing about it just before we went on stage. And it, of course, gets to me in the sky. American Airlines have the prettiest planes. And I literally just went and I started. And when something goes, Jen, for me, that's it. I can't think of anything.
Me neither.
I create a language, basically.
Me too.
A brand
I can't
language.
Say regular English words.
Nothing.
It's gibberish. What is
it's
that?
Total gibberish. And what I hope is that the audience sit there and go, oh, I think her mic must have gone funny then.
Yeah, totally. That's when I just started it.
And I managed to get it back, which was quite frankly a miracle.
Right on.
About a line later. But of course, because everyone is on stage as well listening to you, you know, you can just feel the entire, you know, the 10 of the people just suddenly... And they're all just like, and you know, they are laughing, squealing, trying not to make
any sound. You turn around and there's the shoulders,
And you just know, and that makes it even worse. So I went, I know I've just done sort of a cracker there, and I don't even know what I said, and I don't think I said anything good either. I don't think I made it.
I like
good.
That you got it back. I'm proud of you for getting it back because it could have just been,
Because as you know, it keeps rolling. You know what I mean?
So you're just like, does.
And the accompaniment is repetitive.
It sure is.
So then you're like, I have no idea where I am, actually.
Also, do you know how many times we sing the word suddenly in that one song?
You know, I don't, and I'm really glad, because are you going to tell me?
I'm going to tell you if you want to know.
I want to know.
25. My stage manager told me on my 1,000th show that we sing, and I was like, oh God, no. I'll be singing, I'll be like, suddenly, and the voice in my head is like, suddenly what? Suddenly who?
Suddenly.
You're saying suddenly a lot.
Yeah. The other thing that happens fun in I don't know if it's the same over there, but do you start at 7:30 over there?
No, we start at 7 most nights.
So, because we start at 7:30, you know when we said 8:46, I gotta tear it? That is normally, if it's good, if we've got started on time, exactly the time it is when I say that line.
That's remarkable. That is cool. That's really, really cool.
Yeah, I often come off and these days management's like, do you know that was bang on today? And I was like, yeah.
That is cool. I like when things happen like that. I inexplicably last week said 8:56.
Have you ever done the wrong age? Have you ever aged yourself?
You know what? I have a joke that I do that Chris Ashley does not like, but I throw it in sometimes. And I go, it's suddenly I'm 50 and cover my mouth like I don't. And the audience laughs, and then I do a thing like suddenly and I try to like get him back. Chris Ashley doesn't like that at all, but it's really fun to do.
I once called myself 61,
fun.
And And I'd like to think they were like, yeah, right, girl. Do you know what I mean? Like, you don't. I'm hoping they'd be like that.
Yeah.
But I believe my first cover, Jen Tierney, I think she said like 1956 at one point. So she was like, sure. Oh my God, I just made myself 18.
Awesome. That's so good. Oh my gosh, I'm having a delightful time.
Like sort of the bar when it comes to Beverly Bass in Come From Away, obviously everyone is whoever plays it from then on out, and who, you know, we are just always, you know, what would Jenn Colella do, do you know what I mean? That's where we have to be. And rightly so, you know, you absolutely smash this role and continue to now. And I was always wondering, because I've met Beverly, the real Beverly Bass, on a Zoom call, not unlike this, on a radio show, and I always have a little bit of a fear of playing people that are real and playing people that are still alive, because you really don't want to upset them. If they're not there or they're fiction, easier. But this, obviously she's still around and she's watched you a lot. And I would like to know, I'm a little bit fearful, but I'm imagining that your fear is like tenfold, because, that's the question, you know, was it tenfold? Did you go, I'm so worried about getting this right, because she's there, she's going to watch it and she's going to judge it, because I'm playing her, literally, in moments of her life. Was that a frightening experience? Did you feel like you've got over that fear? Is it a constant fear?
It was very, very daunting at first. Yep. Yes, I was super afraid, because I just wanted to honor her. I wanted her to feel honored. And I didn't know her well at all. I didn't know her at all. I actually met her after the first... I think we were just done with previews. We were about to open in La Jolla the following night, and she showed up but didn't see the show. She was waiting for opening, and we met in a restaurant. We like found each other in this restaurant outside of the theater, and she said, "I think you're playing me," and I said, "I think you're right." And then she started to tell me her story, and she was like, "You know, Tom and I have this map in our kitchen where we put these pins," and I was like, "You don't say." Like she was telling me this whole story. Then Tom comes up and he was like, "Yeah, they, you know, they were like 38 planes and they were on the tarmac for 28 hours. I was like, "Is that right?" I just was like, "You're gonna lose your mind."
Yeah.
She had no idea that she had such a big role. She didn't know what the show was. She had no clue. She was like, "Some kids came and interviewed me years ago and now there's some musical." So when I was doing it for the first time, she was in the third row right in front of me, a little house right, like right where the table and chair is for me in the sky. And she just had her head buried in her hands. And I was like, "I hope this is good. I hope this is happy. I hope that..." I just knew she was totally overwhelmed. And I felt scared, but I also had to trust. I trust Chris Ashley very much. I trusted the show at that point. I was like, "I'm just going to do my best to honor her and to tell the story and say the words like a normal person would." And then after I started hanging out with her and having lunch with her, I visited her in Florida and been on her boat, which she drives with her feet, which is so badass. So now I know what her eyebrows do when she's about to tell a secret. You know what I mean? Now I know
what
she does with her hands that nobody else cares about, but I will throw that in just as a little like tribute to her.
And that is why you will always be the queen. Because you have that. And that is incredible. And that's so nice, isn't it? Because you get to bring that, you know, to every performance. And it's for you, really, that, you know, you and her.
That's
really
right.
That's for no one else. But I love that. That's we could literally talk for like a whole 24 hours. I think we should just do a 24 hours.
I know, I think so too. Here's my last question. When are you most likely to space out during the show? When do you think about your laundry or something else?
Yeah. Or often like what I'm having in between shows, because I can't ever work
that
out.
Yeah, what am I going to eat? Yeah, what am I going to eat? What am I going to eat?
It tends to be, with the greatest respect to the people that sing the song, obviously, costume party. Because I'm meant to be asleep, you see?
Word, that's right.
I can go sort of into sort of like a spacey sort of, I'm meant to be asleep, but not really. we going to have? You know, where should I go? Is it a Saturday? Does that mean London's too busy? Because therefore I won't go out and I'll probably get a delivery. You know, that kind yeah. of, that's the whole conversation.
Yes, costume party is perfect for that. That's exactly right. Because you're chilling. You're in your own reverie anyway.
I think I can even do it when we're doing the, you know, the coat dance.
For sure. 100%.
I mean, I'm still doing it then. I'm still just deciding.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's just, is it? Yeah, so it's definitely that, probably that moment where I zone out and can have a little bit of a moment.
I literally do full meditation during during Hannah's song. Still listening, still using the music, but I, because we're sitting and we're facing upstage, I literally do full visualization meditation to like kind of refuel for the rest yeah. of the journey. Also, that drink of water that you have prior to Me and the Sky, I designed because we used to do the end of Screech and then just go right to the table. Correct. No. And I was like, I literally was like, I need 1 second. I just need 1 second. I need to get this Annette vest off, first of all. And second of all, I got to have one sip of this water before I walk out and do this thing.
Forever grateful. Forever
You're
grateful.
Welcome. My absolute pleasure. My absolute pleasure. 1986, the first female American captain in history. Suddenly I'm in the cockpit. Suddenly I've got my wings. Suddenly all of the pilots were testing me. But they can get their own drinks.
right, okay, my last question.
Okay, love.
You are back finally to do this wonderful role one more time on Broadway. I presume it might be your last time, you never know, but never say never. But you're back in it and you had a little bit of a break. How long was your gap between coming back to it?
Well, it was we came back and did the film during the pandemic, but that was kind of like a fever dream and very quick. So it's been a couple of years. I left November of 2019.
So did it feel like putting on, you know, an old comfortable pair of shoes, or did you get there and shed a tear after day one thinking, I have no idea what I'm doing and what chair do I move?
Yes, great question. It was, first of all, I got to watch it. And I had come as an audience member. I wanted my fiance to see it. But I just wept through the whole thing because I felt so proud of my colleagues that I didn't really get to experience it. But I came back early to watch it several times before I came in and was just moved by the show itself. It's a beautiful show. I also watched from up, we call it the perch, like where the spot ops are. And the lighting is absolutely stunning. The whole show is gorgeous and moving, and like hearing the audience react in that way, and to be out there and to have the chance to watch it, I fell in love with it in another way and had a deeper respect for it. So when I came back, my main goal was to make sure that I was fitting into what everybody else had created, that I wanted to be very specific about my numbers, because I can tell the difference. If you're not right in the center of your light, you're kind of messing up the whole thing. So I'm not great at that yet, but I'm trying to be diligent about the numbers. It was kind of flipped out about it. And then there are moments when it felt like riding a bike, and then there are moments when it felt like riding a rusty bike. I would turn around with a jacket in my hand and be like a sea of chairs. I was like, I have no clue. Nowhere to go.
If anything goes wrong, if a chair has gone wrong, I think I'm just gonna have to leave the stage because I have no idea how to help anyone. I barely know mine. Do you know what I mean?
Yes. Let's go
anyone else's. The standbys, don't they just like blow your mind how they know like four or five different chair props, let alone the lines and everything.
And the vocal parts. It's the chairs, and exactly the right angle. And if it's a little off, somebody will, it's crazy. Have you ever sat down in the wrong chair and been like, this is completely wrong, this is off, this
I
is
came back,
chair.
No, I haven't, but I did come back off holiday once and one of our chairs had broken, so they replaced it, but not told me they replaced. And I picked it up and it was a lot lighter than what I normally know. And I went, I've ruined the entire show, I've ruined it, because I picked up the wrong chair and I am panicking. I'm literally looking around, trying to get someone's eye, going, I've ruined the show. You know, because I think this is a show stop, because if I've ruined, I've ruined the chair.
Yeah, that's right.
It was the right chair, but it was just a different one. Well, honestly, the panic
Correct.
That I went through yes. for about 5 minutes is, because it is, the whole show is based on it. It's so intricate. It's so simple, yet it's so intricate, and
that's right.
it's and that's why it's so brilliant, I think.
That's exactly right.
So listen, I think we've got to our end of our questions.
We did it. I'm so delighted to spend time with you.
I don't want to leave you.
I will never leave you. How about that?
It really has been a joy. I'm absolutely having a fangirling moment. So thank you so much for taking the time, Jen. I know that you're planning a wedding.
Thank you, my love.
Broadway, and it's all happening for you. So listen, to take time out of your day is incredible. So thank you.
It's been my honor and my pleasure. Thank you so much, Alice.
And so, you know, to anyone who's watching, I hope you've enjoyed it. I've been Alice Fearn, Jenn Colella, legend, dream. And please rewatch this and please book tickets to come and see our wonderful shows. These shows have got a life that they will only live for a few months more. Broadway, I believe, are closing in October. West End, we are running until January the 7th. So if you are in any of our countries, please come and see it. But if you're not, there are other productions happening all over the world. If you are ever somewhere where Come From Away is being shown, get a ticket and go and see it. Your day will be changed. Right. Thank you so much, everyone, for listening. Bye, bye, bye. Love, love, love.
Thank
bye,
you, Jenn. Alice.
I love you.
I love you back. I know that our producer is going to want us to continue to ask questions,
but
I just want to hang out with you. Okay. Yeah. We should have a pint, a drink sometime.
Yes.
Right? Okay. We're going to make that happen. I want to hang out. Okay.